Can you hear me?
Yeah.
All right. Thank you for attending this session. It's going to be one of the very interesting sessions. I'm glad you're all here. We're going to talk about services. I'm delighted we have an excellent panel in front of us, and we're going to look at the sustainable development impacts and aspects of services and the gender aspects of services, two really, really important questions for inclusive growth and inclusive trade patterns. So I just want to very quickly say that it's really hard to overstate the importance of services for all of our economies. We know that it's over two-thirds of GDP on average globally, two-thirds of employment, and two-thirds of FDI flows. We also now know with the WTO OECD trade and value-added database that services actually represent 50% of world trade. How many people knew that? Good, very good. I'm really glad about that. I want all the hands to go up next time because this is really, really important. If we look at the balance of payment statistics, 22%, but in reality, services are incorporated into everything we produce and trade, and their real importance in world trade when we add up all of the stages and inputs into final products means that they constitute 50% of world trade now on a value-added basis. For many years, we've heard that services are a developed country concern. This is a developed country agenda. This could not be farther from the truth. Services are, in fact, more important for developing countries than for developed ones. This might be surprising for you in many ways that we may not fully appreciate, but which we're going to learn about in our panel. This panel should be an eye-opener, perhaps for some of us, for many, as we discuss the contribution of services to sustainable development, how important they are to productivity growth, how important they are to SMEs' participation in international trade, why it matters, how important they are to equitable growth, how important they are to greater gender equality, how they can positively impact on poverty reduction and improving health and education outcomes. And I think this panel could not be more important for our topic. So we're entering into very exciting territory. Services can really be a transformational force in all developing countries, and especially the lowest income countries. And unleashing the potential of services is something we should all be focusing on and working hard to do. But understanding what they can do is the first step. So on this panel, we're going to hear first an opening presentation by Professor Wilma Viviers from the Northwest University in South Africa. She's going to lead off our thinking process. Then we will hear from Nicholas Frank, who is the Program Officer for Services at the ICTSD, which is co-sponsor of the panel, and he will speak to us on the potential for services to contribute to inclusive growth. Then we will hear from Dr. Sonia Grater, a researcher who is also from the Northwest University in South Africa. She's going to inform us about how services SMEs may be enabled to take advantage of greater trade opportunities, but the challenges they face in doing so. And then we will hear from Julia. Julia, this is complicated. Lipovieska?
Yeah.
Good. Who is an independent consultant, and she's going to tell us why and how gender matters for services and for more inclusive growth. And I want to thank particularly those of us who have come from South Africa, far away, to be on this panel and to be with us here today. We really appreciate your trip and your contributions. After the presentations, I'll open the floor, and I'll be delighted for any and all of you here to ask questions and participate. So thank you again. I'll ask our speakers to limit their remarks to about 7-8 minutes max. So try and exercise self-control. Thank you very much. And we are going to open with Professor Wilma. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sherry, and thank you very much for your attendance this afternoon. I'm seeing that the room is filling up, so the competition outside with the OECD and the World Bank is not putting you off, and I'm very glad that we have a good audience this afternoon. It gives me great pleasure, ladies and gentlemen, to welcome you to this session on services and inclusiveness in least developed countries and low-income countries, specifically on sustainable development, SMEs, and gender. The purpose of this session is to offer some insights into the research that the ITCSD and the Northwest University's trade research entities and also the WTO chair in South Africa have been conducted in the services sector in LDCs and LICs, and how the development of the services sector has the potential to give greater momentum to these countries' economies so that they can ultimately escape the poverty trap and become less dependent on external assistance, as well as we're looking at the role of gender in the context of services and how gender equality can contribute to economic activity. It is amazing that about 30 years ago, there were roughly 350 different categories of jobs that people could do. And as Sherry also asked you a question, I can maybe also ask you a question. How many do you think, how many job categories do we approximately have today? Anybody would like to guess?
In services?
Generally. Okay. Just generally. From 350, 30 years ago, what do you think? Anybody would like?
1,000.
1,000. A little bit low, 15,000. So today the number of job categories has increased and has grown to 15,000, helped by a large extent, and that is what we are discussing the last 3 days, by the dramatic advances in technology that have been sweeping throughout the world. Innovation and technology are also providing the fuel for the ever-expanding regional and global value chains phenomenon, in which traditional production processes are being sliced up into tasks and outsourced to entities with distinct cost advantages in different parts of the world. These value chains favor specialization, which creates opportunities for smaller players, which we are going to discuss this afternoon. Although they have limited production capacity and market clout, but have a product or a service that can contribute to value-adding process. Unfortunately, despite these opportunities, the poor countries represented by the least developing and the low-income countries remain weakly integrated into the global economy, with many still heavily dependent on low-value exports in the form of raw materials and simple manufacturing. However, the services sector, which includes the ICT, financial services, transport, energy, healthcare, etc., could usher in a new era for LDCs and LICs, especially as it is often easier to transition to varied service delivery than value-added industrial output. And now we come to some statistics which will definitely be also discussed and supported this afternoon with the researchers around me. But globally, services account for about two-thirds of world employment, 60% of FDI flows, and nearly 50% of world trade, as Sherry has indicated, measured in value-added terms. You can see that we are very proud of this number because you'll probably hear it a few times this afternoon. Importantly, services make a major contribution to more than 50% to GDPs in many poor countries, and very often, as in the case of telecommunication networks, internet services and energy provision constitute the all-important enabling environment or the foundation for the function of any economy. So many people are surprised when I tell them that in South Africa, 70% of our GDP is coming from services. And still it is such a low, very little discussed and researched topic. Yet these countries' exports, other than those linked to tourism, which is quite advanced in a number of countries, are in many cases insignificant in terms of global standards. For example, just to give you an idea, the total African services imports is the same as the services imports of France. So the whole continent imports is the same as that of France. And in terms of exports, the African services exports are the same than Belgium's services exports, which is only 1.6% of global service trade. However, as many more people join the global discussion and conversation about the potential of services sector to boost poor countries' economies, as we are doing here at the public forum and specifically also today, the issue of SMEs and their contribution to the services sector is often raised. But the scope and impact of SMEs in the services sector have received little attention, specifically in low-developed countries or low-income countries and least developed countries, by way of formal research, and therefore information is still patchy. But we do know that SMEs operating in the service sector find it difficult to grow their business and become profitable because of a variety of constraints, ranging from infrastructural and institutional shortcomings which hinder their productivity and competitiveness, to difficult policy and regulatory environment. As I've mentioned, the SMEs in the world over make a major contribution to their domestic economies, a country's economies, particularly in the source of employment, but they operate in a kind of a twilight zone, seen and acknowledged, but not properly understood or catered for when it comes to policies and regulations. These problems are more serious in the poor countries because of an acute lack of information about which it is impossible to recognize opportunities, their access to finance, and very important skills and practical assistance. In the LDCs and LICs, SMEs largely fall into the micro category. More than 80% of them are in the micro category, less than 10 employees, which makes it even harder to withstand the challenges and gain traction in the market and create viable businesses. The world today is increasingly characterized by widening inequality. If ever there was a need to unite people again under the common sense and purpose of the vision for the future, it is now. The 17 Sustainable Development Goals and the 169 targets are said to play an important role in this regard, because they represent the collective responsibility of the whole world to eradicate the things that divide people and strangle economic opportunity, particularly in poor countries. Most of the SDGs are in fact linked to the performance of specific service sectors, of which we will also hear this afternoon, such as education, health, transport, and ICT. The overarching aim of the SDGs is the elimination of global poverty. And so it makes sense that the LDCs and LICs should be understood and given the necessary attention and support so that these countries will stand a better chance of overcoming their many difficulties in playing a more active role in the global economy. The US President Barack Obama recently remarked that there's a strong and very noticeable link between a country's level of development and the educational opportunity enjoyed by its female population. The economic marginalization of women is one of the leading factors retarding progress in LDCs and LICs, and is a key focus area also in the Sustainable Development Goals. To get back to services, the development of the service sector could be a game changer for the less developed countries and the low-income countries in their pursuit of economic and job-related growth, and needs to come out of the shadow, specifically at a policy level. The implementation of the LDC services waiver currently underway in the WTO to get easier access for services from less developed countries is a further incentive to give attention to the services sector in these countries. However, more jobs are not always a consequence of higher economic growth, particularly when automation can displace certain types of jobs that have traditionally had a labor-intensive service component, for example, call center assistance, various banking services, and checking counter assistance at airports. Inclusive growth, which is our theme of this trade forum, however, is the result of governance making it easier for entrepreneurs to start business, to grow and employ more people. But similarly, helping more established companies to enhance their capabilities and extend their reach should also be part of the policy equation. In other words, it's not just about creating jobs, it's about creating economic momentum. This is the sustainable inclusive growth formula that so often elude policymakers in the developing world. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Wilma. That was an excellent overview and introduction for us to delve down more into deeper aspects of the services issues and their potential contributions. And you argued really very effectively for bringing services out of the shadow on the policy level, which I really liked. Can we now turn to Nicholas and go a bit more into depth on how services may, in fact, specifically contribute to more inclusive growth? Thank you.
Thank you.
Very well done. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Sherry and Wilma. That's a hard act to follow, but I'll do my best. So as Sherry mentioned, my presentation will focus on three main questions. What are services? What is sustainable development? And how and why do services matter for sustainable and inclusive economic growth? I think it's important to first establish some kind of definitions. And one of the best definitions I've come across comes from the OECD. And if you'll just bear with me, I'll just run through it quickly. It's that services are outputs produced to order and which cannot be traded separately from their production. They are not separate entities of which ownership rights can be established. And they cannot be they cannot be traded separately from their production. They're heterogeneous outputs produced to order and typically consist of changes in the conditions of the consuming units realized by the activities of producers at the demand of consumers. By the time their production is completed, they must have been provided to consumers. And however, there's certainly exceptions to this rule. So there is a group of industries, typically industries whose outputs have characteristics of goods. And these are really industries that are concerned with provision, storage, and dissemination of information, advice, and entertainment, in the kind of broader sense of those terms. Another kind of important distinction to make is between core or backbone services and non-backbone services. And by backbone services, I'm referring to those services which are fundamental to the functioning of modern economies. And this typically includes transport services, communication services, financial services, and energy services. And we'll come back to these later. I would note that productivity gains in those kind of core service sectors or backbone service sectors are really linked to improvements in overall competitiveness in the economy. And as I said, I think we'll revisit this. Okay. I'm just going to briefly run through the four modes of supply and then briefly touch on mode five or the potential mode five. Mode one, cross-border trade, really is most akin to trading goods, where a service is crossing a border. Mode two, consumption abroad, relates to cases where an individual crosses a border to consume a service. So examples of this are medical tourism or educational services. Mode three, commercial presence, relates to cases where the service is provided by an entity established in the territory of another country. And mode four relates to the movement of natural persons. So when a worker actually crosses a natural boundary to, or national boundary to provide a service. Mode five is potentially one of the most interesting, and it's not covered under the GATT, but it relates to services that are embodied in goods. So going back to this discussion of trade and value added, the TIVA database, this illustrates it quite clearly. So in the EU, up to a quarter of all trade-related jobs would be accounted for by mode five. And this would account for about $300 billion in EU exports. So it's potentially the most important component of trade and services. What's that? Okay. So I'm going to briefly kind of reinforce the case for services. This data is a bit outdated, but I think what it illustrates is that The global economy is really in the process of a transition to a service-led economy. And that regardless of levels of development, services are occupying an increasingly important role in the share of GDP. So, and again, this is probably not surprising given the input function that services perform in modern economies. And one of the stylized facts of economic development is that the share of services in GDP increases as per capita incomes increase. And this is related to both supply and demand factors. Elasticity of demand for services, the rise in demand for coordination and intermediation services, and that's associated with structural shifts in the economy. So movements away from agriculture and from manufacturing to services. And the expansion of incentives for firms and households and governments to really spin off service activities, what we refer to as outsourcing. So services also, this slide illustrates, I think, that services again matter for a wide variety of economies. And I'm just going to focus on Ethiopia because it's quite an interesting case. So Ethiopia is an economy that has traditionally been dominated by its agricultural sector, specifically the coffee exports. And currently, services account for a larger share of forex earnings. In fact, twice as much forex is accumulated through service exports than through coffee exports. And this is a pattern that's kind of replicated across regions and across economies. China is the big exception. This data is from 2014, and my guess is if it were updated, those shares would become much, much closer. Okay, this services also matter for value addition and structural transformation. This is the infamous or famous Smiley Curve, which was developed by Stan Shi, who was the head of Acer Computers in the 90s. And in the 90s, Acer had found itself in the position where it was a primary manufacturer of computer components, but had faced pressure on its margins. And she worked out that the real kind of nodes of value addition were at the edges of the Smiley Curve, which tend to be service-led activities. So this is your marketing, your logistics, your research, your advertising, brand management, things of this nature. Then continuing the kind of value-added story, so you can see East Asia and the Pacific, Sub-Saharan Africa, and South Asia have some of the highest growth rates for value addition in services. And admittedly, these regions may be starting from a lower base than OECD economies, but I think what it does indicate is that there certainly is kind of latent potential there for further expansion of these service sectors. Services also really matter for productivity, and this is just Ethiopian labor productivity data going back to the Ethiopian example. And what is clear is that service sectors exhibit much higher levels of labor productivity than the traditional agriculture and manufacturing sectors. And in terms of agriculture and manufacturing labor productivity growth, you could make the additional argument that productivity gains there have actually been led by improvements in the inputs of services into those sectors. So that could be what is driving those gains. The argument is also sometimes made that service jobs tend to be low-wage jobs. And this is minimum wage data drawn from the Lesotho Government Gazette. And the thing that stands out is that a trained machine operator, which is traditionally considered a good manufacturing job, earns less than a cleaner or someone involved in retail or hospitality. I think it is hard to make the case that in all cases services are low wage jobs. This indicates that even in LDCs this is not the case. Okay, returning to sustainable development. Again, if you'll just bear with me, I'll give you 30 seconds of sustainable development. So There is a lack of a universally accepted definition for sustainable development, but one of the better ones comes from the Brundtland Commission, and I'll just read it briefly. Sustainable development is development that meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. It contains within it the key concepts of one, the essential needs of the world's poor to which overriding priority should be given, and two, the idea of limitations imposed by the state of technology and social organization on the environment's ability to meet present and future needs. And then following from the Brundtland Commission, we have the Johannesburg Declaration in 2002, which clearly articulated the three pillars which make up sustainable development. That is economic development, social development, and environmental protection. And leading from that, we had the MDGs, which were agreed in 2000 by governments and were composed of 8 goals, but the goals were quite narrow in their scope. So the SDGs are much broader. So the SDGs tackle issues ranging from poverty reduction to the protection of marine ecosystems. So the scope is significantly wider. Okay. So the growth effects or the relationship between services and economic growth has been covered in the literature far more widely than the non-growth effects. And I'll take this opportunity to shamelessly plug ICTSD's recent publication on services and sustainable development, a conceptual approach, which lays out this relationship. I'm going to focus on the non-growth dimensions of services because I think the growth dimensions have been covered or will be covered. So in terms of the non-growth dimensions, I think it's possible to draw three distinctions. One relates to direct effects, and this relates to cases where an SDG is associated with the performance or access to a particular service. So the classic example would be if you're interested in improving educational outcomes, improving the quality of your educational services is where you start. Then we have an indirect income effect, and this is related to economic growth, but it is possible that economies can experience economic growth without widespread distribution of gains, and this is what we're talking about with the indirect income effect. Then we have other indirect effects, which are potentially the most interesting. These could also be kind of considered second-order effects. So when a service that's not directly mentioned in the SDGs contributes to the achievement of an SDG. Another example of this is financial services in the agricultural sector, or financial services in environmental services. And I will provide, that's just the schema, so you can see how it all links together. And I'll just give you one example, and this is the potential contribution of transport services to sustainable development. So transport services are directly mentioned under SDG 11, which relates to safe and sustainable human settlements, and it's explicitly mentioned in the targets. However, there are a number of indirect effects. For example, improvements in transport services can have knock-on effects in improvements in the cold chain with resulting reductions in waste and presumably improvements in access to foodstuffs. Similarly, improvements in transport services can really facilitate school enrollment and attendance and educational outcomes. I'm running out of time, so I will stop it there. And I'll just make three key points. Services are widely traded. They're characterized by high levels of value addition, or can be characterized by high levels of value addition, and that they are tightly linked to productivity gains and improvements in competitiveness. They're also critical to the operation of regional value chains and global value chains. It's hard to imagine a value chain operating without service inputs and competitive service inputs at that. And that they're really a necessary ingredient for sustainable development. And that in order to achieve sustainable development outcomes, a real focus on services and the service sectors is required. I think I'll stop it there.
Thanks very much, Nick. That was a great, great overview of services. I really like the points that you brought out and the I think, very original graphs that show that, you know, some of the highest rates of services value-added growth have actually been in the developing world. I think that was a surprising, that might be surprising to a lot of us. And the fact that services jobs are not necessarily low-wage jobs. And that, in fact, what you found in one country in Africa may even be the case for many, many countries of the lower-income countries around the world, if we actually looked at the figures and did the studies. So I think this kind of, you know, actual looking at the numbers is helps to displace a lot of myths that we might have about services and actually how very positive they can be. So let's turn to Sonia and have her talk to us about services and small and medium-sized enterprises. Thank you.
Thank you, Sherry. I appreciate the opportunity. It's hard to follow these two presentations, but I'll do my best. Just as context, the work I will present today will be a small portion of a paper we are working on at the moment, trying to really understand the link between services and service sector SMEs, and especially now in the developing countries. Now, bearing in mind that the data is very limited or patchy, as we mentioned earlier, it is a challenge to really bring these concepts together. But we've tried our best to bring some form of a scoping paper to bring up some ideas of how to take this further in research as well. So I will be talking, we've heard a little bit about the link between the service sector development, economic growth, and poverty reduction. I think it's very important for least developed countries to recognize the role that services can play in this. So I will be looking at the role that service sector SMEs can play, how these sector SMEs can contribute to sustainable development, and what kind of policy requirements there might be or actions that governments could take. So I'll try to do my best to do this shortly as well. So just to start at the base, but I think you've heard this a lot the past few days, is the common definition of SMEs. We've stuck to the World Bank one, which classifies micro firms as any firm under 10 employees, small firms 10 to 50, and the medium firms 50 to 100. You need to bear in mind, though, that there are other sources that classify the medium firms up to 200 or even up to 500 in the EU, which makes it quite difficult statistically to really understand which firms are incorporated in this SME classification. Many of the SMEs in these developing and least developed countries are also informal, so they are not registered for tax purposes, and that makes it even more difficult to measure. There's also, from what we find in these developing countries and low-income countries, is a missing middle. There's a lot of micro firms, as we've mentioned before. I will show you a little bit of statistics just now. But there's quite a lack of medium-sized firms that are growing in the longer term and sustainable. So SMEs in developing countries tend to be less productive than those in developed countries, and they engage in more labor-intensive activities. And they are largely part of the domestic economy and not necessarily trading as much, where we do try to find in this study kind of how to engage service sector SMEs more into global value chain activities, even if it is through the indirect export chain or the smile curve, as we so nicely saw just now. Some very limited statistics now, keeping in mind that there is very little on this. The IFC data is showing us on some of the LDC countries that most of the SMEs in these LDC countries, or 90% of them, are micro in size. So you're sitting with a large amount of firms that are survival type firms, operating really in just service sectors such as hairdressing and personal services. There's no real incentive to grow further than that. And then interestingly, some of these economies do show that we have anything between 30 and 40% of these SMEs in the services sector. So there's quite a large amount of small firms in the LDCs and services, and we hope that data in the future will give us more insight into that. We also find that the distribution of service sectors in each of these countries are very different. For example, Bangladesh focuses very much on health and education and has performed well in that sector, where Mozambique has been focusing much more on hospitality, tourism, etc. And you can look for many of these examples in the LDC countries. Tourism in general is still a very strong driver for growth in many of these LDCs, but we find that technology and developments in the last few years are providing opportunities for service firms in education, health, ICT, energy, transport and logistics to really expand their scope, and especially in these value-added activities. They do not need to be a very large firm to slot into a value chain. But we do find definitely that the service sector SMEs are not receiving any attention, if at all, in policy level in the LDCs. There are few that we can identify that have some policies on it, and really try and make them part of the sustainable development agenda. Many LDCs and LICs, what I'm trying to do here is just illustrate some examples of how, again, services can link with the SDGs and how one can incorporate the SMEs. So I will just briefly show you our thoughts on four of the sectors I've just mentioned. In education sector, we find that many of these LDCs already have a weak education system. They are sitting very under-resourced. There are no funds for this. And a potential solution could be to form education partnerships with foreign institutions, learning for new technological forms of online delivery platforms, and incorporating your SMEs into that. There are some strong, small firms that would be able to link into this and become agents in education or franchises, etc. And so the technological developments are offering many opportunities. And we also try to, as you could see, link how the sector would link with many of these SDGs. We've linked them to quite a few. The health sector, similar, is a sector in LDC countries that are performing poorly. There's no funding. And there's definitely poor management, et cetera. But we find that if one could use maybe some creative thinking, there's many opportunities for small services firms to support private institutions with computer system design, accounting, training, radiography. You can name quite a few related services, not just the health service itself. So transport and logistics, I think, have been dealt with, but just again, transport spills over into all sorts of fields, including tourism. And it's a labor-intensive sector that does not necessarily require such high skills of education. Could be a sector for many of these LDCs to really grasp more opportunity and slot into value chains. And ICT, I think, is one that we've heard a lot in the last few days about, but I'd like to just highlight again that I think small firms in the ICT sector have got a lot of potential to slot into this. It does require, most of the time, higher levels of skills, more investment. You need a reliable power supply. You need a supporting business environment. And for that, policy is very crucial. But if you could get it right in an ideal situation, they could definitely slot into all sorts of ICT, online banking. We are seeing a lot of development in Africa on smartphone payment methods that are developing very, very ad hoc as these countries are facing problems. And they are reacting quickly and innovatively to find solutions to it in the private sector specifically. So there are different factors that drive service sector SMEs. I won't dwell on this too much, but it's very much either factors. You can also see it very much as obstacles in the least developed countries. They are dependent on a strong market and a strong demand, and your local demand in the LDCs are small. Most countries are small countries with low growth, and the potential is really only in areas like tourism. They need knowledge, they need information, they need ease of access, they need facilitation through internet availability, transport, finance. The regulatory environment is critical. We heard about mode 4. I think that's very much, we need to draw the attention to this, because service sector firms are very much affected by visa requirements and problems that affect the movement of people. And you can also trace this back to standards, licensing requirements, and et cetera. They need access to training and learning opportunities, whether it be given by government or whether it be from other private sector firms. There's ways of linking small firms with large firms. We've heard some case studies in the last two or three days in many of the sessions where large multinationals are able to incorporate smaller firms and help them, and also transfer knowledge and training through to them. So we're trying to play with many policies, but this is very difficult. You know, we always get asked in the South African context, how do you force a multinational to work with small firms? And you can actually not do that unless you can offer some form of incentive. But I believe there are ways to do this, you know, and we mentioned things, I won't go through this in detail, but we are talking about public-private partnerships that might be an option. Service sector SMEs need definitely a more prominent role in policy, and what we do highlight is that we need to recognize that these SMEs differ in size, they differ from sector to sector, their needs are different, their location is different, and the stage in their life cycle. So when you formulate a policy for services and SMEs specifically, you cannot do the policy for all of the sectors unanimously. You have to try and find some way of distinguishing between these service sectors differently. And we need more private sector involvement because the private sector works on this daily and they can aid in the policy formulation. We also find that trade agreements and liberalization of service sectors are still key. It's definitely something that needs to stay on the table. And countries need to find ways to market or brand their strong SME sectors that they find they have an advantage in and find a way to link them to multinationals. They could cluster service sectors. We find many examples of this in South Africa, where there are incubators created and platforms created for small firms to interact with each other. So each firm might not have all the skills, but together they might be able to offer a set of skills. And other platforms are important. Online platforms are important. They need platforms to talk to government. They need to be able to communicate their problems and not be overseen at a policy level. And they need to be recognized. We also admit that there needs to be much more research done on the service sector, especially in the LDC countries. And we need to identify more the needs of these firms specifically and how to help them, because we definitely see a link between service sector SMEs and sustainable development for these countries. I'll stop there. Thank you.
Excellent, Sonia. Thank you so much. Really very useful and pertinent and down-to-earth presentation. And thank you for pointing out that SMEs don't need to be large. And I think this is so important in terms of size or capital base. They can still be small, and yet they can provide inputs or slot into GVCs in the appropriate conditions. And so what's really crucial in this context is to see what kind of useful suggestions of policies can support SMEs. And I really like that you distinguished them by sector and emphasize the regulatory environment as well. Thank you so much. Now, please, Julia, can you inform us about gender and services?
Thank you, Sherry. So it's hard to follow these acts, but I'll try to keep it brief. So services account globally for almost 50% of female employment, and particularly in advanced economies, the share of employment of women in industry has halved, and most women have moved into services, where now 85% of women are employed, primarily in health and education. In developing countries, on the other hand, a lot of women are now moving out of agriculture and straight into services. Over the past decade, the share of women employed in services has increased by about 8%. In developed and developing countries alike, we see horizontal and vertical labor segregation along gender lines. This means that women are represented in a more limited range of occupations than men. They're particularly concentrated in wholesale and retail trade, tourism, hotels and restaurants, health and social work, education, and community social and personal services. At the same time, we observe vertical labor segregation, which means that women are concentrated in more low and medium skilled jobs, such as clerks and service workers, and shop and market sales workers, which you can see on the diagram. Globally, female participation in ownership of services firms is actually a lot higher than in manufacturing. And a potential explanation for this is that in services, firms have a much lower entry cost and lower capital requirements than manufacturing firms. And as many women struggle in terms of accessing finance, it's much easier for them to enter the services sector as a business owner than the manufacturing sector. So Nicholas already explained some of the links between services and inclusive growth. Talk more specifically about the links to gender equality. So we know that services can drive economic growth, and as countries develop and household incomes rise, families are more willing to spend money on education and health of girls, which contributes to their ability to enter paid work in services sectors, but also the wider economy. Countries where services account for a higher proportion of employment actually also have higher labor force participation rates for women. So the presence of employment opportunities in the service sectors can result in women being more highly valued socially and economically, and increase the perceived returns on investment in girls' education, again, creating more incentive for women and girls to be educated and to enter the labor market. Also, it's important to note that in most practically developing countries, women assume a disproportionate share of family and community support responsibilities, such as childcare, but also caring for the elderly. So an improvement in the availability and affordability and the quality of services can significantly reduce the domestic and social care burden on women, allowing them to engage in formal employment. This is particularly important in terms of childcare, but also the example Nicholas mentioned in terms of transportation, allowing girls to go to school, allowing women to access further off markets. So now, what is the link between gender equality and economic growth and competitiveness? So in the short term, greater gender equality stimulates growth, particularly for the consumption channel. So as women have more disposable income, they can spend in the economy, they can invest. So in the long term, they can also contribute to economic growth through their savings. At the same time, equal access to educational opportunities for women means that there's a greater accumulation of skills and expertise in the labor force, and potentially raising the growth potential and the productivity of the economy. We also know that greater decision-making power for women over household resources and family size usually enhances human capital for the next generation, as children benefit because women spend a lot more of their income on health and education of their children. As the service sector is particularly skills intensive, this is really important because in the future you will have a more educated and skilled labor force. So under the GATS agreement on trade and services, mode 1 and 2 offer the most opportunities for increasing women's participation in services. Under mode 3, which involves firms offering their services for establishing a subsidiary or a branch abroad, there's a bit more limited opportunities for women entrepreneurs who, as I said, often lack access to financial resources but are also smaller in size. However, women wage workers can benefit from establishment of commercial presence of foreign service firms in developing countries, for example, through business processing sectors. Under mode 4, the temporary movement of people, there's some potential for women's participation. However, for now, the services that have been liberalized are on the higher qualified business professionals side. So most women actually do not meet these requirements. And those that do often face the issue of lack of recognition for their professional qualifications. The paper that was published by ICTSD this month and is available, I think, at the entrance to the room, looks at women's role in key service sectors, including tourism, ICT, financial services, and health and domestic care. I won't go into these into detail now, and I'll rather focus on some of the common challenges that women face across all these sectors, particularly in developing economies. So as I said, there is one of the key issues is vertical segregation of women. And women are generally concentrated in occupations that are characterized by lower pay, longer hours, and often informal working conditions. And this has implications for liberalization of trade and service because, as we know, liberalization creates winners and losers. And since women are clustered in fewer sectors, and often have limited access to resources, they might be less likely to enter expanding sectors and are more susceptible to informalization and vulnerable work. So they might lose out due to trade-related adjustment. Vertical segregation is equally present in the service sector, and women often concentrated at the lower skilled, lower value added end of the value chain with limited career opportunities. Women are also more likely than men to be found in precarious forms of work, as this graph shows, which is characterized by short duration contracts, low wages, limited access to social security benefits, low skill requirements, and lack of representation. Important in this is time poverty because of the constraints that women face in terms of their time, because of the social care burden and domestic care burden that they have. They actually might seek out these types of informal employment, even though this type of employment is actually quite unattractive in terms of long-term income generation. We also know women are paid less than men. So globally, women earn on average 60 to 75% of men's wages. And we can also observe this in some of the specific service sectors. Lower earnings over lifetime usually lead to lower savings, lower pensions, and lower economic independence. And for a large majority of women working in the world, around 830 million of women don't have access to maternity entitlements. And this particularly contributes to high maternal and child mortality ratios in some developing countries. So women entrepreneurs engaged in trade and services face very common challenges as most women, employed as are owners of SMEs in developing countries. These relate to access to productive resources, access to input, equipment, capital and credit, but also access to networks and markets and information on how to access markets abroad. With regards to educational and vocational training, boys are more likely to be sent to school than girls, who often stay at home to assist in household duties. So this contributes to lower levels of educational attainment among women, making it hard for them to access higher skilled jobs. And due to the time poverty that women face, they often have trouble accessing training as adults and really becoming skilled entrepreneurs because they just don't have time. So I think that this is quite important that when paid and unpaid work are combined, women in developing countries work more than men and have much less time for education, but also for investing in the businesses that they own. So finally, what are the implications for this? So I think key to addressing some of these challenges is really working with both the public and the private sector. Some of the policies that can facilitate women's access to labor opportunities and services relate to provision of childcare, regulation regarding equality and non-discrimination at work, but also policies that encourage greater sharing of domestic responsibilities between men and women and expanding social protection, particularly for women who are employed in precarious or vulnerable types of employment. For the private sector, much of the focus has to be on changing organizational culture in terms of pay, working conditions, and the quality of work that is provided to women. This relates to improvement of the provision of training, provision of mentorship opportunities for women, but also ensuring a better work-life balance for women who have a domestic care burden in terms of flexible work, et cetera. I think in the age of social media and greater brand sensitivity of consumers, voluntary codes of conduct such as the UN Global Compact, women's economic empowerment principles can contribute to some success in this area. But I think you still need regulation and legislation. So mainstreaming gender in trade policy is really important in order to allow women to access equal opportunities in trade as men do. And particularly, most countries, when writing their trade policies or export promotion strategies, don't consider services and particularly don't consider the specific role that women play in services. So this really has to be rectified in order for women to access the same types of opportunities as men do when trade expands or when trade is liberalized. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Julia. I always suspected that women worked more than men, but now you have confirmed it. So we need to redress this, I think. But thank you so much for explaining to us the really important link between gender equality, economic growth, and competitiveness, and how this can lead to poverty reduction. I think these links are not always well understood, and they're really, really important. So the women's role in services in particular is a key element in poverty reduction. And we need to keep this in front of us. But we also, and I think you did a very nice job in explaining the many challenges we face still that would allow women the ability to participate more actively in services activities and for us to reach these positive results. So thank you for that. I am not going to ask the panel any questions because they've already told us a lot of things. I want now to turn to you. We do have a half an hour for discussion. That's great. So I would like to know whatever is on your mind. I can put a couple of things out to you from the floor that you might want to think about, but whatever question comes to you, please feel free to ask it. I was thinking that with all of these potential benefits to be derived from services in the area of growth, in the area of trade, in the area of promoting SME participation, in the area of reaching greater gender equality and more inclusive growth, why is it that policymakers in developing countries have not and still are not putting more emphasis on services efficiency and services reform? Why are they still not mainstreaming adequately services in economic policy? You might have a thought on that. And secondly, does anyone have any comments or questions or doubts about the links we tried to make up here in the panel between services sector development, economic growth, and poverty reduction? So if you have any doubts or you have any, you know, questions on this, please feel free to raise it. I open the floor to you. Thank you. The gentleman in the back. If you want to say your name, please, and your questions briefly stated, that would be great.
Thank you so much. My name is Taufik Rahman from Indonesia. The services sector in LDCs and LICs is a backbone for the economy, we can say. But for example, if we analyze, I mean, from the presentation, we can see that actually the value added coming from service sector is very dominant. Even though, for example, for certain countries like Indonesia, most of our products is commodity, for example. But if you analyze in terms of value added in the inside the commodity, actually service component is quite dominant. I'm particularly interested in Sonia and also Julia's presentation. I agree so much with what Julia has explained about the women empowerment is very important in terms of developing SMEs, because again SMEs is the backbone of the economy in LDCs and LIC, but the problem is most of the players behind those SMEs actually is women. And to expand the role of SMEs in these countries, in those countries, actually we need to have more innovative platforms. What Sonia said, that online platform is going to be very helpful to expand the capability of those SMEs to reach greater access to market, for example. That's very true. Based on my observation in my country, for example, in Indonesia, a lot of small companies able to reach greater market access because of online platforms. They able to access more market. They can get more interactive relationship with others in other countries. Even for example, it's because of the help of online platform. But to help the women, the women is the problem, because most of women in those countries is mostly uneducated. I mean, less educated in comparison with the men, for example. So what I would say is we need some orchestrated approach to help those countries in terms of policy setting. For example, we have to encourage them to be more services concentrated approach instead of products, for example. So my question is how to really help those countries in terms of capacity building, helping them to have more effective policy making framework to really help focusing on services and also helping the women empowerment in service sector. Thank you so much.
Thanks very much. Thank you. Very pertinent question. I want to take two or three and let the panel think for a little while before we reply. Can I have another one? Thank you so much.
Hi, my name is Akio. I'm working at the Inter-Parliamentary Union in Geneva. Just one question. What role do you think that parliamentarians can play to promote services? Thanks.
Thank you for that question. Very pertinent. Thank you. Also for the opportunity for the panel to think about it. Thank you. Not an easy one, but we're going to think. I'd like to take another one. Please, Matthew.
Thank you. Microphone for the speaker, please. Microphone for the speaker, please.
Connected to that, if you are an LDC or an LIC and you do open to a services trade, it seems to me the services trade you would receive would be mostly at the middle size or the larger companies, not at the micro level. So would there be a two-tier type of services trade that would develop a micro level, which would not really be subject to competition with international service providers, and a medium size, which might be? And would that phenomenon have an impact on the first part of the question? Thank you.
Just think about it. Excellent, great. Tough question, one more, and then we'll turn to the panel. Thank you.
Hi, thanks. Some are comments and some are, actually most comments. My name is Lisa Karanja, and I work at Trademark East Africa. And one of the largest components of our programming is in services, both from trade policy, from our trade policy department and my department, which is in business competitiveness. And I think there's just a couple of points. Somebody asked about why, I think you yourself asked about governments becoming interested. I think that it differs from country to country. There are some countries in which services is slowly becoming an area in which the government is interested in defining public policy. I think Rwanda is just beginning. Kenya has a very large services industry, particularly in tourism and in other areas. And one of the areas that we haven't spoken about is professional services, such as the provision of lawyers and tax experts and accountants and so on, that Kenya actually engages in quite significantly to other African countries. So I think, one, we have to understand that we have to disaggregate the services industry. We can't just have a one-size-fits-all. And I think we also have to understand that different countries are at different levels in terms of developing data. We are helping a number of governments to develop proper data on services. And formal research is taking place to different levels. I think on the issue of SME development, we've done a lot of work on these ICT platforms. The big issue is sustainability. What happens is, when trademark goes away, they stop sustaining the platforms. And there is an issue of people not wanting to pay for information because they've been burned with various services. So we have to look at how can we commercialize some of these platforms so that they remain viable after we've disengaged. And in terms of the jobs, and wanting to increase jobs for poor people in services, it's not just increasing the number, but the level and quality. Otherwise, we will not have that impact where, for example, Julia, who we work with quite closely, so she won't mind me saying this, where, for example, Julia mentioned, you know, you'll get more cultural acceptance. If your jobs are, if the services jobs remain in small hairdressing or cleaning, or frankly, one of the largest services for women, although it's illegal, is prostitution, then culturally, it won't lead to acceptance. So we have to look at the quality of jobs, and therefore, we also have to look at education, and so on. And so there's a combined approach. I think that it's very important to understand that you've got to address trade policy at the same time as addressing information dissemination, capacity development, and so on. I hope that was quick.
That was good. It was a big tour de table, but it was good. Very important points, especially the one on quality and level of services jobs. It's true. Okay, I think that's perhaps enough questions right now because I want to give the panel sufficient time to reply. I'm going to turn the first question over to Julia because it was more specifically on gender from our Indonesian colleague. Thank you very much, Julia.
Thank you. So I think the question you raise is really pertinent, and of course, ICT and the digital economy creates numerous opportunities for women to access new sectors, particularly when they face mobility issues. It's particularly attractive to women because of this double care burden that they face in terms of their domestic responsibilities. So if they can still care for their children but run a business from home, that's really great. But I think there's also really a huge difference between regions. I know in Asia, ICT has enabled a lot of women to access new markets. I think I read in a recent World Bank report on the digital economy that 4 out of 10 sellers on Alibaba are women, which is great. But there's a huge difference. I mean, in Africa, 12%, only 12% of women have access to internet. You know, a lot of them still don't have access to mobile phones. They're less likely to have access to mobile phones and especially smartphones than men. So I think while the internet and ICT provide a great opportunity, that doesn't mean you should throw out other traditional means of engaging with women. So I think, for example, Trademark has done quite successfully is built as associations of women. And often why women are not represented in policy making around trade and services or why they're not being connected is because, you know, no one knows they're there. When a woman works as a domestic worker in a house, she has no representation. She might know a few other women who work as cleaners, but doesn't know that there's actually thousands of women. So, for example, in India, there's an organization called Sewa that's been quite successful in terms of organizing women in the domestic sector, and they've helped not only women be more aware of their rights, but also access, you know, training, access better better skills, better jobs in the sector. So I think, yeah, I agree with you, internet and the digital economy can provide huge opportunities, but I think we still have to be very creative about the solutions that we come up with.
Thank you very much. It's a very good reply. I would now like to ask Professor Vilma if she could address the question from our colleague from the Interparliamentary Union in Geneva. Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry, I didn't get your name, but thank you very much. Just your name?
Akio Afuda.
Akio, yeah. Thank you very much for this question. Yes, I think in the case of, as a parliamentarian, I think the most important thing is that information should be shared. Information of the role that services can play domestically, but specifically in terms of international trade. And we have seen in our own country, and I've seen also from the statistics that we've seen today, that in all countries, manufacturing is going down, while the services growth is going upwards. So if in terms of economic growth and everything associated with economic growth, employment, reduction of poverty, etc., the services sector has just been the stepchild, and it hasn't been given the attention. And I think I would recommend a very small but very, very effective communication through parliaments by showing what is the effect of services right through the economy, from employment to productivity to higher wages, as we have seen, the possibility of creating employment, and then specifically the role that it can play in the new trade environment. We are trading in a new world, and the new world is global and regional value chains. And their services, as we have seen, is really the backbone. And it's the enabling environment in which regional and value chains, global value chains, can take place. Because that means that no country has to produce a product in total anymore. The specialization is the key word. It's the slicing up the value chain, which makes it possible for services to be part of that value chain. We are going in South Africa having a whole range of workshops where we invite the government officials to participate, to understand. Because 2 years ago, I was in a session at our Department of Trade and Industry, and it was already the fact that manufacturing was going down. And when we spoke about what are the opportunities of services, for instance, in South Africa, there's a high establishment of call centers, and I was explaining this phenomenon to the Department of Industry, and they said at that point in time, services is future music. Now that was really a shocker to me, and but I just realized is that people don't understand the whole domino effect that can be created with services. In a short span of 2-3 years, a call center is creating 3,000 jobs. And in telecom, and in one of the floors of this building is a multinational organization, which is the call center sits in Durban. I know that a big motor fan manufacturing is now setting up a call center in Cape Town. That is, I would say, a phenomenal and an exponential possibility of job creation, which is not necessarily possible in the new codifying environment that we are, where many of the manufacturing jobs are being taken over by machines. So we see that many of the jobs are lost in manufacturing. But these jobs that can be created in the services sector can be high wages jobs, and of course it's higher skills, and one gets this trade-off between losing jobs but winning on the other side, higher skilled jobs. And therefore, education and ICT is just very important. So to sum up, I think it's a question of that this knowledge and this information about the role that services can play domestically, but specifically in global value chains, must be put to the parliaments. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I hope that you will go back with these suggestions and get your parliamentarians to adopt a program focused on services. That would be excellent. Great. And very good. And we'll hear it next year in the world and the public forum. We want to hear the outcome of this. That would be great. Okay, let's turn to Matthew's question. And I've actually, because it's a little bit complex, I've actually asked for two of our panelists to respond to this. So you can decide which order you want to.
Okay, then
I'll take the first part of the question because I think it's easier. I think it's important to first draw the distinction between regulation and liberalization, because I think the two terms are often kind of lumped together. And people think that if you liberalize your service sector, it means you deregulate your service sector. And I would make the argument that before liberalization occurs, domestic regulatory frameworks have to really be strengthened. Given how intensive the regulatory intensive nature of services, at the end of the day, it comes down to domestic regulations. And most issues revolve around domestic regulation. I think liberalization is necessary, but before that step can take place, frameworks have to be established, in many cases first established and then strengthened. And then I'll let Sonia go.
Yes, I think I'll just kind of expand on that because from what I see in our own scenario in South Africa, for example, is before you can start negotiations on a multilateral level, you need to understand your service sector very much. And a lot of research has to go into your own country to understand where's my strength sectors. Not all service sectors are necessarily important to your country. So there could be three or four that you really see potential in. And those are the ones you're really going to go for also in terms of international access and things in the longer run. But the aim should really be to first understand your domestic scenario. And when I think to expand a little bit where you made the distinction between the smaller firms and the larger firms, I definitely agree that there are a level of SMEs that are not tradable. And you're not going to force the local hairdresser to now offer a service internationally. You have to make that distinction. That's why I very clearly in the beginning tried to create this understanding of the definition of SMEs, because we have to very clearly understand that not all SMEs can participate. And there's also a place for them. There's a role for each of them. But those that are able to trade and those that do show statistics we've seen recently shows that almost 70 to 80% of SMEs fail in the first year. You have to first get them across those hurdles. And then when you find those smaller firms that are able to grow in the longer run, those are the guys you need to hold hands with. And for me, I think to add on is, you know, discussions between public, private sector, government, academics is so important to raise these issues, raise platforms, workshops, however you can do, to try and figure out what is your needs in your country and what would be the best way to go about it. Because I think there's no one-size-fits-all approach. I hope that answers your question.
Thanks, and maybe I can take the liberty to say something as well. I think that the scope for tradable services has dramatically expanded over the past years. We used to look at services as, you know, maybe a little bit are traded, and the most of them are actually not traded. And now we look at it in very much the reverse. There are very few services that are not potentially tradable and not potentially traded. And so I think our universe of opportunity for firms has expanded dramatically, and that's a really critical element of this conversation too, because the opportunities also expand along with that. And for the lower-income countries, of course, the access to the world market also has to go through a very, how should I say, up-to-date as much as possible IT and telecom sector, because that's really their link to the rest of the world. So that cannot be ignored. We don't have a whole lot of more time. If anybody has a burning question, put up your hand. Otherwise, I'll draw the panel to a close. So would anyone like to ask one final question? Or are you happy and satisfied with our discussion? All right. Good. Then let me just, in conclusion, first and foremost, thank our panel. I think you've all done a great job. It's been excellent. Very high quality of presentations, excellent questions. And I hope you have a few takeaways from this session. I guess the main takeaway I'd like you to have is that services are very much a developing country agenda. This is really important.
The services sector provides many, many opportunities for greater participation in international trade for SMEs from lower-income countries, has contributed to higher value-added growth in lower-income countries, and even to higher-wage jobs. We've also learned that greater gender equality can be realized by having more women employed in the services sector, and that can also crucially lead to poverty reduction. Services are often the conduit for firms to participate in international trade through finding a foothold into a global value chain operation. And so, in conclusion, the second takeaway is services need more policy attention within your governments at the national, regional, and multilateral levels. So please take the message and help do this. Thank you very much. And if you can remember and have the wish to, there are feedback forms on your table to fill out. Thank you so much.